So finally, let's take a look at this NAND flash memory chip. So as I mentioned earlier, your iPad or your iPhone has anywhere between 16 gigabyte to 64 gigabyte of this storage, all of which is essentially in the form of this NAND flash memory. And when you open up this NAND flash memory chip, you see multiple of these NAND flash dies stacked on top of each other. And each of these individual dies look something like this. So shown here is a 8 gigabit memory, or a 1 gigabyte of memory. This is from a slightly older technology, 56 nanometer. Nowadays you get 4 gigabyte of memory capacity in each single die. And again, when you open up this die, it looks like most of the area on your die is occupied by this memory array. And each of them consist of these NAND, these flash memory cells arranged in a NAND fashion. So what do we mean by arranged in a NAND fashion, or what do we mean by a NAND array? So for any memory system, there are two ways you can arrange them. So you can arrange them in a NOR fashion. So this is shown here as an array of 16 cells. So shown here is the 16 cells arranged in a NOR fashion. And on your right, shown here are the 16 cells arranged, or 16 or more cells arranged in a NAND fashion. So what I mean by a NOR architecture is that you have each of your cells individually addressable, which means that this bit line is connected to each of these individual cells. So you have your word line, which is, so this is word line one, this is word line two, and then you have this bit line. So this bit line in a NOR architecture is connected to each of these cells. So whenever you want to address a particular cell, you select that particular word line and you select that particular bit line, and you can address that particular cell. One of the limitations of this architecture is that you have to land this, make this connection between this bit line and each of these individual cells. So you have to land this contact between your bit line and each of these cells. And that makes it not the optimal design in terms of areal efficiency. On the other hand, one of the advantages of this architecture is that since each of the cell is individually addressable, it's faster. On the other hand, in the NAND memory architecture, you don't have individual bit line contact to each of these cells. So this is your bit line, and it runs across each of these cells. So essentially, your bit line is these source drain of these cells connected together. So how do we address each of these cells? So if you want to select this particular cell, you select that particular word line. So you select that particular word line. And to access this particular cell, you now have to turn all of these cells on. So you have to turn all of these cells on if you want to reach to this particular cell and read the state of this particular cell. So that makes it slower. But at the same time, it makes you don't have individual bit line contact each of per cell. So you now have essentially a very compact array, as compared to here, where you have it fast, but at the same time, it's not the optimal in terms of area efficiency. So this is the NAND architecture that is used in the flash memory, primarily for the reason that it's the most efficient way to pack these memory cells in a given area. And it's a very simple architecture where you have these multiple bit lines and word lines, and they are running perpendicular to each other. So again, if you take a areal photograph, there's a very large probability that you will land something which looks like this. So when you look at this, you the first feeling that I get is, they look like essentially skyscrapers, right? Each of these cells look like skyscrapers. And what you have are these are the bit lines. So these is bit line one, this is bit line two. And now you have this isolation between these bit lines. So you have this very deep trench which is isolating these two bit lines. It's also known as a shallow trench isolation. And then you have this word line which is again running across these multiple bit lines. So this is the word line and these are the individual bit lines. And so let's take a closer look at one of these cells. So if we take a closer look at one of these cells, it looks something like this. So you have essentially your this is your bit line, and this is again your word line running on top of each other, top of these bit lines. And in between, you have this floating gate, which stores the charge, so it stores the bit. And so there's a quick so here's a quick intro of how this flash memory cell works, if you're not aware of it. So to program this flash memory cells, you apply a very high voltage on your word line. And what it does, it essentially char it causes tunneling of charge from your bit line, which is made up of silicon, into this floating gate. So now you have charge stored inside this floating gate. So now, depending upon whether there is charge in this floating gate or not, the threshold voltage of this transistor below in the bit line changes. So essentially, you store charge in this floating gate, and that affects the transistor, which makes up your bit line. And it's also a non-volatile memory. So you once you store this charge, it's stored in the cell for roughly 10 years or so they say, but at least a year. And then if you come back, your bits would be still stored in here. So let's summarize what we have seen so far in the cross section. So we looked at the cross section of the microprocessor, the DRAM, and the NAND memory cell. And looking at the microprocessor, we saw that this huge mesh of interconnects. So it looks like if you take a cross section, it mostly looks like a mesh of interconnects. When we looked at our DRAM, we got the feeling that it looked like these antennas or these horns of a deer. Which were the capacitors which were storing the charge. When we looked at a NAND memory cell, it looked something like a skyscraper where we had these individual bit lines which were very tall and they looked like skyscrapers. And so the point I want to emphasize is that the process technology that goes into making a microprocessor is very different from what goes into making a DRAM than what it goes into making a NAND flash. So far we haven't gone into the different steps, but just by looking at this picture, I hope you got some idea of how different the process or how different the final chip looks if you take a cross section. Also, I want to summarize some more aspects of each of these individual chips. So, a microprocessor, as we discussed in the introduction as well, if you buy an ARM-based microprocessor, it will cost you somewhere around $25. If you buy a microprocessor from Intel, it would cost you somewhere around $100. Similarly, DRAM, it costs roughly $7 per gigabyte. NAND flash memory similarly is much cheaper. It's $1 per gigabyte. So why are a NAND flash memory, as we discussed, is non-volatile? And the other microprocessor, SRAM and the microprocessor and DRAM are both volatile. So as long as if you just remove the battery from your phone, you lose all the data and your DRAM and your microprocessor. But all your contacts and your music and your apps, which are stored in your NAND flash memory, would still be intact. So if this memory is non-volatile, right? And so why is it cheaper? So the reason why it's cheaper is because of this thing called the speed or the access time, which you can address each of these bits. So in a SRAM, you can select address these bits very quickly. So they have an access time of between 1 to 10 seconds, depending upon whether it's a level 1 cache or a level 2 cache. A DRAM is 2 orders of magnitude higher, so it has a time of 100 nanoseconds. And again, NAND flash memory is 2 orders of magnitude higher than this, so it has a time of 1 to 10 milliseconds. So that's why even though this is non-volatile and it's slow, you can buy it for cheap. And also, we saw that we use up to routinely use 16 to 32 gigabyte of NAND storage. And that is enabled because it's a very compact cell. So each of the cell, if you measure in terms of feature size F, NAND flash would be 4F square. A DRAM is between 6 to 8F square. SRAM, again, it's a humongous inside. It's 100F square. And to finally summarize, let me summarize, so who are the main players who makes microprocessor, who makes DRAM, who makes NAND flash memory? So microprocessor, of course, the brand you might recognize is Intel. It sells a lot of microprocessor for laptops and both servers as well as desktops, but very actually nobody, yeah, not no presence in negligible presence in tablets or smartphones. All of the Apple chips, A5, A6, so far they have been primarily made by Samsung, which is actually who makes these chip out of a fab in Austin. And a lot of companies like Nvidia and Qualcomm, which sells these microprocessors for your cell phone as well. So those are made by TSMC or GlobalFoundries, which are essentially foundry services which make these chips for other chip IDMs. DRAM, again, the biggest supplier of DRAM is Samsung, followed by Hynix. Both of these are Korean companies. And Elpida, which used to make DRAM but recently went bankrupt. The only American supplier of DRAM is Micron. And NAND flash memory, again, number one player is Samsung. Number two is Toshiba. Number three is again Hynix. And there's also this IMFT, which is a joint collaboration between Intel and Micron. And they also make NAND flash memory chips, and they are the number four player. So if you see who makes microprocessor as well as makes DRAM as well as makes DRAM. So there's one company which stands out, which does all three. So Samsung makes microprocessor, it makes DRAM, and it makes NAND flash memory as well.